Chinese title, by the way. And that's why the whole room is full now. It's very exciting. So be excited. I've got some really exciting stuff to coming up in the presentation. But first of all, I want to thank you, the organizers, GMGC, because I think it's really amazing that finally there's a massive game event here in the Philippines. It's one of the first ones, hopefully of many to come. And I'm really excited that this is kind of our home base as well. We've got an office here. So it's nice to see that there's a community starting around it. And thank you, all of you, for coming for this presentation as well. So we'll get straight into, because I know you're all excited about how to basically double your mobile game revenues. And I'm going to be talking a bit about how our own experiences with it, what we have done. And I want to try and make it as practical as possible. So as many of you get as much value out of this presentation as possible, and you can actually take some of these things and go directly back to your game production and implement them, and hopefully see some of the similar returns that we have from it. Exciting much?
Yes.
Alright. Just before I jump in, how many of you are actually indie developers, just by a show of hands? Okay. How many of you are publishers? And how many of you are not in the game industry? You are. I know you. No. Okay, and the rest of you? Too shy to do my mention. Alright. Well, this is the main indicator for game developers and even publishers that can benefit from using this information with their publishing deals and the studios that they work with. So let's get straight into it. There you go. This is a little bit of thing about me, and I thought to gamify it. I've got, I rated myself a 90 out of 100 marketing skill. Background story of that is actually I've allocated more than $4 million in marketing spend across the different game titles over my the last couple of years of doing user acquisition and across multiple networks for a bunch of our successful titles in Playlab. I've been 8 years in Asia, and I, for the attentive watcher, I also have 4 cats, and very big fan. Oh, lots of people love that as well. And it's so send me cat videos, please. I'm very interested, and I always forward them to my girlfriend. But I'm 29 years old. Started Playlab actually around 4 years ago in 2012. We actually got successful with our very first title called Juice Tubes, which amassed more than 25 million downloads, top grossing on multiple charts, both Google and Apple, for 5 consecutive months. Last year we actually got nominated for our newest title, Super Slam, for Game of the Year and Editor's Choice on both platforms. And we're actually, I believe, the first studio to ever get nominated out of Southeast Asia for Editor's Choice on Apple. So very exciting for us, and that's the background story about Playlab in a sense. So how do you double your revenues? You basically, simply enough, and this is kind of for obvious for most people, but you have to double your revenues by selling up. Most indie developers do, they think and focus too much on building product and everything else, but if you don't think about the sales process in it, you're not going to be able to get the revenue out of the users. And so that's what I'm going to be delving into here in the next couple of slides. The industry knowledge there's in this one, is basically just for everyone to get some of the insights that we got. This is gathered from different presentations. The first one is 54% of users buy a second time within the first hour of the last purchase, meaning this is from a study from Amazon where they looked across all of their whole games sphere, and a lot of developers don't consider this. So if you actually time when you present offers to your users correctly, you can actually multiply your sales significantly compared to your other competitors in the gaming space. So that's why it's valuable. And also, just for note, some of you probably know this already, but it's only 0.2% of your users that account for 50% of your revenues. So the whole games industry in itself is extremely whale driven, and those are things that you really have to consider when you're developing your game. So I'll get more into that in some of our next slides. General conversion to users is 0.5 to 4.5%, depending on country, geo, platform that you're on. So your game basically is not going to be converting 95% of the users. But a lot of game developers are focusing on those 95% of the users and not on the actual paying users. So if you want to build a business, which is what we've done with upwards of 100 people in Playlab, you need to think about the economics of doing games as well. So, and that's what I'm emphasizing here. So keep these things in mind as I go through the next couple of slides. And the majority of top 100 grossing games, they have more than 7 items for sale. Indie developers often think, if I just sell this treasure box or this virtual currency, then suddenly I'm going to be able to generate the revenues that I need to. But in reality, you need to have a multitude of products that you're offering, because some products are going to be catering to a certain type of user and some other products are going to be catering to other types of users. And so that's purely from deconstructing the top 100 games, that if you don't have 7 products, then it's a very fluid amount, because the very successful ones actually go up and have upwards of 11 to 14 products, different type of products that they're selling to their users. And so that's something that you need to take into account as well. How do you practically actually double your game revenues? If you're a mobile game indie developer, this is kind of what I've broken it down to, and it's the same process that we're doing in our live operations team, where basically all you need is a graphic designer to design different messages or promotions or sales to your users. The second step is you have to consider where your placement is. I'm going to go into each of these topics more. And then you need a tool for publishing these types of campaigns. This is not specifically actually a requirement to go out and buy an expensive tool for this. We have done that, but it's not a requirement to do it. You can hard code it into your own development in your own game, and you will see the same results. It's just going to be a bit more difficult to manage things on the fly. For example, if you put an offer in the beginning, you can't change it until you put another version out, or if you build it very advanced, then you're capable of doing that. But there are solutions out there, and that's the point of it, that you can. But from an indie perspective, shop around and look for different solutions for that, if you're not willing to pay for the more advanced solutions out there. And then last of all, you need analytics, so you can actually see where you're driving, so you know what campaigns are working and which ones are not. But I'm going to jump straight into it, and basically these are just a small snapshot of the graphics that we are running and have been running and are still adapting and changing. And it basically, you can see some empty space in it. That's because we change, for example, the sales offer depending on the different targetings that we do. So if we're targeting paying users, they get a higher value offer. If we're targeting non-paying users, they get a much smaller, like $1 or $2, just to get them kind of converting from the get-go. So as you can see, we try to customize it as well, and your designer is going to either hate you or love you, depending on the mentality of your designer. But you're going to be creating so many different variations of this. One for what, as you can see here, we've done a New Year's resolution, we have a Christmas one, we have a limited bundle offer, we have weekend sales, Thursday sales, Wednesday sales, basically sales every day of the week, to try and make it more appealing and give the users a sense of urgency to buy now. And as you can see, most of them we've actually added a secure payment for it, because we've noticed that actually helps in conversions, which is why we put it in there. And also with some of the things that we do via our live operations tool, is we add a timer to it, so we can actually say this offer only stands for 15 minutes. And we see the same thing. When you put a sense of urgency in on these offers, that they actually convert significantly better, because it's, you only get one chance to buy it. You want to buy now, or you might never see it again. And users tend to resonate really well with that. Moving forward, and when your designer thinks he's done, there's basically much more content to come out there. It's the ones down in the corner here is basically things that are rotating banners that you've implemented into a social casino game that basically rotates around and shows offers and guides the users to the offers that we wanted to see. The other ones is actually completely integrated into our coin store. So when we run, for example, a Christmas event or a New Year's event, then the whole feel of the buying experience is different. And that's something that users like, because they see that there's something changing all the time, that there's actually people on the other side of the game, and it's not just a static game. And users tend to get bored if there's no new content, or it doesn't feel like there's something new happening in your game. So this is a really good way also, when we actually implement these full coin score graphics, then we see a significant uptake in our revenues from that. So first step, if you're running a studio, is get a graphic designer and get him making some promotions. Then the second step of it is actually figuring out, where do I place this within my game? These are some of the good examples that we've had with. I'll go through the first ones here. It's just, these are some of the examples where users don't, or game developers don't think about, where can I place these promotions? And I think there's a different promotion that fits with a good placement in the game. So you have to consider it, how it fits into your game, but look at some of these spots in the game where you can actually upsell to the user. So for example, if the user tries to buy something, and then, for example, Google Play either rejects it, or they change their mind in the very last moment because they clicked on a $10, then it's a brilliant moment to actually give them an offer for a $5 offer instead, because then you get them converted onto that. So when the user thought they were going to buy 10 and change their mind, then you can throw them a smaller offer and actually get them converted still as a user. So that's just one point in the game. You can also do it after your purchase to do an upsell and say, you've already bought for $10, here's a buy for another $5, and we'll give you something extra as a token of gratitude for it. And then you can actually get multiple purchases in within a very short time frame. When you're out of your virtual currencies, it's an obvious point. Instead of just waiting for the user to find their way to the coin store, throw it in their face and say, right now, here is an offer for you to get back to doing what you were doing before without having to look around or browse around your lobby or your coin store or things like that. The lobby, if you have that, or basically the waiting screen, is always a good, convenient time to do it. A good thing we've experimented with that is put a timer off before it pops up, so you don't show it when the user actually gets straight into the game, but maybe wait 2, 3, 4, or 5 minutes, so after they've gone in and done whatever they do in your game. In our game, it's play one of our slot machines. They play maybe for 15 minutes and then they come back into the lobby. That's a brilliant time again to present them a secondary offer. Because they've just had a natural end to that session, so it makes sense to pay, buy some points, and you can continue doing what you've been doing before. Again, extra X time in the app, so you can control when, depending on your metrics for a specific game, how long are the average session times. You can start making decisions on, should it be after 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, and for the users that maybe have played for 30 minutes, they get to see different offers than the ones that only play for 20 minutes, because your objective is to get them converted and get them converted on a day-to-day basis as well. And if you get any questions, I'll be having a Q&A just followed after this, where you can fire any questions that might arise from this. The last one I had was actually when you are closing the coin store. It's below this. When you're closing the coin store, you can see the users decided not to buy, but you can throw another offer into the loop that is better than the offer you have in your coin store, and you can actually convert a significant amount of users from just doing that over and over again. And again, the newbie offer is a very basic thing. That was actually what we started with, was promoting the first time the user comes in, we give them a $10 offer to say, you get this bundled up, and that's one of the first kind of conversions that we see. And that works across our Max 3 titles, our casual titles, and even our social casino titles, this kind of starting offer overall. The next step in this is basically tools. We use Swerve. It's a paid solution. I can't mention cost, I think that's you have to talk to one of their guys there, but we're basically using them. There's a lot of other tools, that's a DNA, Lean Plum, Mixed Panel, I think does it as well. There's many tools out there where you can manage all your campaigns from, and that's when you get more advanced. But spend some time researching what works for you as a game studio, and keep in mind for these solutions, there's generally cost involved for managing that for you. So you have to look at your game economics and say, does it make sense if, let's say, I double my revenue from $100 to $200, or is it from $10,000 a day to $20,000 a day, then you can offset the cost that way. But you kind of have to have some economic glasses on looking at it in that way. And as mentioned, you can hard code it in, but it's really difficult for you then to monitor and change and adapt things along the way. Your iterative process and figuring out what works for your game is going to take a lot longer. And the last step of it is basically using analytics. So when we are running, when the coin store basically is closed, or when we run a Tuesday offer or a Sunday offer, we track everything about it. So we know how many users got to see it, how many times did they get to see it, and how many of them clicked on it, how many of them ended up converting as a user. That way we can really start drilling down and see, well, this offer performed really well. It's a bit hard to see on this one, but basically the concept is the top one that's marked here is our, for example, our Tuesday offer. We've got a 5% conversion rate and click-through rate, so 5% of the users that get to the show, they click through, and then after that we have a 10% conversion rate. So out of the 5%, 10% of them end up buying for that offer over a specific time period. This is very dynamic as things change, whether you're running purchasing behaviors also change throughout the week, whether it's Saturday or Sunday, or it's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. So those are things that you can have in mind, but you need to kind of get a clear vision of who's seeing what and what's working and what's not working when you start running multitudes of campaigns, and especially what they buy. That's kind of the key thing. If you throw them a direct offer, $5 direct buy right now, you need to be able to track who bought it and how many people actually ended up buying from it, so you know your conversion rate. So that way, when you bring this information back to your designer can then go, oh, that worked really well, and maybe that graphic or whatever I designed, or maybe I hit the buy button too far in the corner, didn't work as well as it should have. So analytics kind of helps you put the glasses on where you should be emphasizing on, because as anything else in the Pareto principle, for the ones who know, it's the 80-20 rule, it's probably going to be 20% of your campaigns that generate 80% of the results. And so, yeah, start out with a lot of campaigns and then you zone in on the ones that are actually working. The math behind this to double your revenues are, in this example here, if you have 10,000 daily active users, you show all of them two impressions, you get 5% click-through rate out of that, so 5% of the users that actually see your promotion or your offer ends up clicking on it, and then you have another 5% of those users that end up buying, in this example, a $10 offer. you actually end up with $500 out of those 10,000 DBU, which equates to a 0.05 ARPDAU increase. And depending on your game, that can in itself, the math behind it, can double your revenues or your daily revenues from running these promotions. And that's just an example of one campaign. Especially if you're targeting your paying users, you can get from impression to actual conversion, you can get upwards of 25% conversion. So your paying users are more inclined to continue paying. And if you jump back to the former slides, where 0.2% of your users accounts for 50% of your revenue, it's really important that you look at the paying users and the recurring paying users, and you provide them with the right type of offers, and you maximize your profit from those users, because basically it's a very small amount of users that's going to be providing the majority of the revenue coming from your game, and therefore sustaining your business. Confused? Make sense? Yes, all right. But don't get confused. I'm going to break it down like very easily for the indie developers so you can get started with this. Super easy, and you don't have to do it as advanced as we do. You can do it a lot simpler way. How we did it, this is just the visualization of it. This is from December. We weren't actively running, reaching the users with our campaigns during the first part of December. Then we started actively running these campaigns, and our average revenue per daily active user bulked up during that period of time. And there was direct correlation to which campaigns we were running, to certain campaigns that we were running, that were providing this additional increase of revenue. And as you can see, even on December 31st, or New Year's Eve, we were running an offer on that day, and it's very visual at the end of it that there's specific, actual, tangible revenue coming in from doing this. How to do this? Get your graphic designer to create one or more offers. You can start texting him right now, just put one offer to begin with, so you can put that out. I'd recommend doing a starting bundle for your users. Either start with, you have to experiment whether $2, $5, or $10, but that's kind of the range that makes sense for most users to buy something at when the user straight gets into your game, or maybe after the newbie guide is a good time to place that. But select a placement from some of the suggestions I had earlier, implement it into your game, and launch it. Make sure you track all the analytics from that campaign, how many clicked, how many bought, what's your conversion rate on it, and then basically it's just rinsing and repeating this thing all over again in the different positions and throughout your whole game. But the easy way to get started with a starter bundle, and that's what I would recommend. But start now. Don't just, like a lot of other indie developers, they know these information, they go, oh yeah, that's great, and then life gets in the way. This is tangible stuff where you can actually multiply your revenue significantly by doing this effectively. A few more bonus points on how you can increase your whale spending and monetize users that are not your whales yet, but could be. Your ads, video ads, rewarded video ads, depending on what type of game it is something that very easily placed. Again, placement is crucial for where you implement your video ads. That increases your ARPDAU by somewhere between 1 cent and maybe 5 cents, depending on your genre. If you're in social casino, it's much higher. If you're in a very casual game, it's going to be a lot lower because advertisers don't want to pay as much for casual users as they want for social users or for hardcore users, for example. So that's going to be very dependent on your game. Don't spam anyone. Give the offer at the right time. Everybody hates spam. So be thoughtful of who you're targeting with your campaigns. Startup offers, again, can be for everyone, but if you're throwing a $100 offer to all of your users, they're not going to be buying it straight away. Better reserve that for your whales and the users that are okay with spending $50 or $100 for the purchase. And again, if you present to most whales a $50 or $100 if your game's good, and they bought that before, they're much, much, much more inclined to actually buy it again. So repetitive of the kind of spending power of each user is important to be tracking as well. So if users get used to spending $25, you're going to see them consistently buying $25. But if you upsell them to a $50 purchase just once or twice, then that becomes their new norm. So they start spending at $50 going forward from that. And that's one way to think the sequencing of how you promote your offers into the game. So you're always building up the spending and the per purchase value of the specific user. So that's another thing. Don't be cannibalizing your users. We've done this mistakes as well, so it can also backfire if you do it wrong, in the sense that if you have users that are willing to spend $25, but you present them with a $2 offer, they're gonna buy a $2 offer, so you get your conversion, but they might not be buying again for that day. So you can cannibalize your users. So that's why we point back to my other point is, once you get them spending, don't promote smaller offers, at least not all the time. Only if they haven't spent for a while, then it makes sense to try to bring them back by giving them a smaller offer. Again, I can't iterate this enough, 0.2% of your users provide you 50% of your revenue. So it is always focused on your whales and your whale retention and your spending users. Keep them happy and don't bug them with too many offers going around. Last thing is basically, those were some of the bonus points that you can use as well, but keep focus on just getting one campaign into your game, see the results from that, and then start iterating on it, and you'll see the results very, 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 very fast. Any questions?
I have a question about giving first-time offers. Like, let's say you have 10 SKU, I mean, yeah, let's say 10, 5 SKUs for like credits, like this $100, $50, $30, whatever, probably the lowest like $1, right? And for the first time ever to, you know, get convert them to purchases, each SKU gives them double the value, only one time. Have you actually tried something like that, and was it actually effective?
Yeah, we run that as a first-time offer, mm-hmm. Where we give, I think it's 40% extra on your first purchase. Mm-hmm. It tends to work very well for mm-hmm. conversions.
So it's a one-time offer?
Yeah.
And from that point on, do they continue purchasing that specific one-time offer repeatedly, that price, or do they go, you know what, I'm gonna buy them all and then possibly drop off, or possibly, you know, just go to the price point that is somewhat equitable to them?
So your objective with running a first-time offer is to figure out which ones of your users are spending users. So your only objective is to convert them. Once you know that they're converted, then you can upsell them other things. But I wouldn't want to run a first-time offer multiple times same user. So it should be, it's only to validate that they have a credit card, they're willing to spend, and then you figure out how do you actually get them continually converted.
All right, thank you.
And as a note to that as well, it's also the drop-off between the first purchase and the second purchase is the biggest, so if you can convert, if you focus on getting from the second to the third purchase, then you have much lower drop and decline of users and spend per user after that. So not only converting them the first time, but converting them the second time, then you're going to get like a committed user that's willing to spend for much longer, and the drop off in purchases is going to be much, much, much lower. So focus on that.